Hello, welcome to my talk, Full Stack Swift with Arduino. Now, what do I mean with full stack? For a lot of people, full stack means being able to create a website from like the low level to databases, to an API backends, and to front ends, like websites. And yes, also, but for me, full stack means the Internet of Things, being able to create a device, which is, they call an edge device, which has a sensor, and propagate that information to your mobile phone. So case in point, I have some plants and I'm always very bad with watering them, and then they die upon me. It's terrible. So why not just put a little moisture sensor in the plant pot, connect that to a little computer, and have that information sent to the cloud so that you can connect to it from your phone. Now the problem is these little computers, I have one over here, are not always capable of connecting to the internet. So in this case, it collects the data and has to send it over to a more powerful computer, in this case, a Raspberry Pi, which I also have here. And the Raspberry Pi is way more capable and can connect to Ethernet or Wi-Fi and is able to create websites and stuff. And then from your mobile phone, you can connect to the cloud and get your data. Now, normally you program these little devices using C++. And to get the data from a serial port into your database on the Raspberry Pi, you would, for example, use something like Python. And then to create the website and an API, you can use many technologies like Node.js or PHP, whatever you want. And then, of course, the mobile app, you can create an Objective-C. But nowadays, we mostly do that in Swift. So, recap. We're coming back to this picture later. We need to create an Arduino program. We need to create some sort of tool to get the serial port into a database. We need to create a backend and a website. And we need to create a mobile app. So we have lots to do in this talk. Let's go. But first, what is an Arduino? Well, I showed you this before. The Arduino is a small, it's an open source electronics platform created in Italy in 2005. And this is a robust controller. It does not run an OS. You program bare metal. Things that you program on this, it executes without any interference from other things. It's hugely popular with the non-tech and creative, but also with technical people. And for example, here are some projects that are done with an Arduino. On the left, you see some people that created a home automation. You have a walking cat. You have people making little robot carts. Some guy created a hand gesture recognizer, a step counter, which uses an accelerometer in your shoe, and also a little robotic hand. Furthermore, Arduino is hugely popular to create musical instruments and stuff like that. Now, the problem with this, with the Arduino platform, is you program it in a language called wiring. And wiring is in a turn based on a subset of Java called processing. But wiring, in this case, is programmed in C++. So basically, you're programming in C++. So what does it look like again? Well, you have your hash defines, which are macros to use, for example, for constants. You have an ifdef to select which library you want to use. You have your integers. You have your function there with unnamed parameters. So when you call it, you never know which parameter is what without documentation. And on the bottom, you see an old C-style for loop. So some time ago, I created a little device which needed to be connected to multiple Wi-Fi stations. And the problem is, I have, so you have these SSIDs from multiple networks, and you can put them in a C char array, but that's sort of terrible. So I thought, okay, let's just put them in a C++ string array. But the Wi-Fi library, of course, needed C char pointer strings. So I have to convert them back and forth, and always also copy them. It's like, what kind of copy do you use? Do you need a string copy, or do you need a string uncopy? Which one is safer, and how do you malloc and free your memory? So you get all these mind swaps, which and what to do, and like semicolons, semicolons. So luckily, Swift to the rescue. Several years ago, Dylan McKay created an LLVM-based cross-compiler for the Atmega processor. The Atmega processor is used on the Arduino boards. With the cross-compiler, you could compile code that was already in the LLVM, you could compile to this little processor. So let's go to some terminology first, because I'm using many different terms which are maybe unfamiliar to iOS developers. The Arduino is the little board. So, for example, this one. The Arduino was created in Italy, and the whole platform is named after a bar in the neighborhood of Turino. And Torino. And there are many different versions. You have bigger versions, smaller versions, and depending on how many outputs you want to have. And the Atmega, on the other hand, is the processor that is on the Arduino. And also there you have many different processors. You have processors that are easy to solder, for example, on the left. You also have processors with many, many input and output devices, which is very handy if you need to connect to multiple sensors. And the Atmega is the line of processors from the company from the line of processors, the AVR line from the company Atmel. So now you're sort of up to date with all the terminology. With that Atmega LLVM compiler, a friend of mine a year ago created a program called Swift for Arduino. It's a standalone IDE which contains the LLVM and the Swift compiler for the Atmega processor. It has a built-in uploader so that you can compile on your Mac and then upload the firmware to an Arduino. It's independent of the Arduino app, so you don't need the app from Arduino itself. And it's also independent of Apple. What that means, I'll explain later. The cool thing now is that you can use libraries and can create libraries which are written in Swift instead of in C++. So that's very nice. Let's have a little demo what this IDE looks like. So this is the integrated development environment. It looks a bit like Xcode. So visually it's similar. On the right hand side, you see the source panel where you write your Swift code. And there are tabs for multiple files. And then on the left of that, you see your snippets panel. And these are drag and drop code snippets, which you can drag and drop in your source. And there are many different types of code snippets. For example, you have serial communication, you have communication for neopixels, for sensors, reading and writing analog and digital values, and also special code to drive neopixels, which are individually controllable RGB LEDs, which are very nice, which I'll show you later. Then on the top you have your build and upload button, which is similar to the run button in Xcode. And on the right there you see a drop-down menu where you can select which Arduino board you want to upload to, because you can be connected to multiple boards, of course. And then on the right-hand side you have other panel toggles. And if you click on that, you'll see on the right-hand side the console, which shows the build process and the upload process and any errors that might occur in your otherwise flawless code, of course. And on the bottom, you see the serial communication, which you can use to communicate with the Arduino under which you are debugging. and show the output of your program. So what would a talk about Arduino be without blinking LEDs? So here's some stuff that you can do with it. You have some, yeah, basically these are NeoPixels, so you can basically have a sort of display of very powerful and bright LEDs, which you can use for many different purposes. These are used for Halloween displays and all kinds of fun art projects. So the Atmega processor, at least the ones that are used in the Arduino, are very small. I mean, it's not die size, but it's a very small chip. So we cannot use the full Swift. We need a subset of Swift. The processor is 8-bit and it has 2 kilobytes of RAM and 32 kilobytes of flash. Now, to compare this, this is like a million times less powerful than an iPhone. And some things in the Swift runtime cannot be implemented on this small and teeny processor. It does run Swift 5.3, but some Swift features are missing. Which features are missing? Classes, dictionaries, and dynamic strings. And the main reason for these is twofold. Memory constraints. You only have 2 kilobytes of RAM. And for example, with classes, you have a lot of overhead and you need a heap to store the classes and stuff like that. And there is just not much space for that. Remember, the very first Mac from 1984 already had 256 times more memory than this little chip. Another very important thing is on an embedded device, you want predictability. For example, if you have a robotic arm that goes back and forth, and suddenly some parts of your code take a millisecond longer than you're used to, suddenly that arm could be somewhere else and could hit someone or could drive a drill somewhere. So you want predictable code. You don't want a background process doing stuff so that your foreground process is unpredictable. For example, funny thing, last week there was this problem with Apple having slow servers, and suddenly all the apps that you start up on your Mac didn't start up or became very slow to start up. If that would happen on an embedded device, bad things could happen. So classes are just not supported, dictionaries are not supported, and so that's mostly memory constraints, and also dynamic strings is mostly memory constraints, because UTF-8 support requires a lot of runtime time support and would make it really slow, and the library is just humongous. Partly implemented are arrays and strings. Arrays only since Swift for Arduino 4.0. And then there's a little star there, because we can't have dynamic arrays. Arrays are best allocated at the start of the program, and you have to remember to release them. Now, the arrays on iOS and macOS are very nice, because they are sort of magical things. For example, if you have an array of 100 items and you just append another item, in the background, the Swift runtime will create a new array of 200 items and will copy your array into that new array, but you don't notice that. For you, it's just magical and you just append something and you're done. But when you go from the 99th item to the 100th item, which you append, suddenly that operation takes a lot longer, because it has to do this copy on write thing. And that's unpredictability that you don't want. So in Swift for Arduino, we have fixed arrays and we define them at the start of the application. String interpolation is another thing which is hard to implement, and that has to do with the fact that the processor architecture is not the von Neumann architecture that is used in most of the processor nowadays, but on the Harvard architecture. And in the Harvard architecture, program space is completely separate, is a completely separate address space from your data. So on the Mac and on iOS, when you do something with strings, basically your whole application runs from RAM. But on the Arduino, your application runs from Flash. So you can't write, you can't modify your own application. And because there's so little RAM, you don't want to copy all the strings from your application into RAM to do stuff with it. So to work around that, we created our own string library called the AVR string buffer, which does small, simple things with strings and not the huge string library from that Apple includes with Foundation. On top of that, there are additional functions because you need a lot of stuff that you simply don't have on your iPhone. You maybe want to send an analog value. You maybe want to do pulse width modulation. You want to read analog values. You want to set digital pins. You want to drive NeoPixels or an SPI bus or an I2C bus. So there are a lot of additional functions for that in Swift for Arduino. And finally we can have closures in embedded code, and that's very nice. But also with a caveat, because in a iOS or macOS closure, you can use self. And self, of course, points to the class that you're running from. And that needs to be maintained and takes up a lot of memory again. So if you want to access variables from your closure, you can access global memory only, because underwater, underneath, it uses a C convention call, and C convention cannot use local volatile memory. If you want to know more about this, there's a YouTube talk for this, which I can point you towards if you're interested. Now, little sneak peek to the next version. The current version is 4.1. And next version is 5.0, and 5.0 will have hopefully command line tools so that you can use your own scripts to do things and maybe even create a plugin for Visual Code if you want to use that. And we also love to have better C++ integration, because there's a huge amount of code out there for sensors and dedicated chips, LCD displays, and it would be very nice if we could use that huge library of libraries. So ideally there would be some sort of drag and drop thing where you drag and drop your C++ library and it creates a Swift proxy facade to be able to use in the Swift for Arduino IDE, but not yet. So back to the project at hand. Remember this image. We had our mobile app, which was in Swift, and now with Swift, server-side Swift, we can create a website and an API in Swift, of course. Normally I would ask who has written server-side Swift before, but there's completely no feedback, so maybe you can answer on Slack. And there is also a thing called command line Swift, so you can use the Swift on command line to create a little tool that grabs the stuff from the serial port and injects it into a database. And now we can finally get rid of C++ and use Swift on embedded devices as well. So everything's Swift. Let's make this. But first, think about the architecture for a little bit, because we need some protocols. And not the Swift protocols or the Objective-C protocols. No, I mean communication protocols. Because from an API to your mobile phone, it's well defined. You can use HTTP, you can use JSON or XML, and you can use that to communicate with the backend. But from the Arduino to the Raspberry Pi, it is not so well defined. You basically have to do it yourself. We can use JSON, but JSON is not really a stream. So it's tricky. We need to have a simple serial value and we need to capture that reliably. So if you're naive, you could think, oh, I just sent the serial values. But then it could be that you only read half of the value when you start listening. And it could also be that one value sort of merges with the other value. It's nicer to wrap each value into a little packet, for example, with a square opening and closing bracket, so that you have a packet start and end, and you can more reliably determine which value you need to capture. So we need to create four applications. First, stage one, we start with the Arduino application. Now, each Arduino application consists of a main run loop, which in the Arduino IDE, you have a dedicated setup function, which is called, and you have your loop function, which is called. And in the setup, you define your in and output ports and constants. And then in the loop, you measure your values and you send your values and maybe update some pins or LEDs, what you want to do. And the loop is similar to the main run loop on iOS, but in Swift for Arduino, we have to do everything ourselves. So I'll show you a little code. At the top here, you have your import of the AVR library. And then, I can zoom in. There's a type alias for how to define the pins. And then we define the hardware pins. Remember, where's this little board? On the top and the bottom, you have these black rows, and these are basically a connector where you can attach things like analog values, digital in and output ports, and you define in your code which of these pins you want to use for your application. So we define where the LED is, and we define where the sensor is for the water, and we also define some constants, how often I want to blink an LED, and we have a high and a low set point when it should blink an alarm that the earth is too dry. Then, in our setup, we set up a serial port, the baud rate of the serial port, and we define which pins are inputs or outputs. And I also set up, a library for the NeoPixel, and at the bottom you see a thing called setup watchdog blinky. Now, when you're creating hardware, it's nice to know if the device is still running correctly. And if you switch on a device and you see a green LED lit up, you know it has power, but does it still run? So I always like to have a little blinky thing, so that you know, when a LED blinks, at least my application is still running. So I do that here. I set up an interval callback timer every couple of seconds, which calls back this routine, and then it sets a variable to the blinking variable to true, which I later pick up in the run loop, and I'll lit up the LED. I blink the LED. And I also set a pin to high value, so that that's easier to debug if you want to debug hardware with an oscilloscope, so that you can see nice pulses on the measuring device. So then in the main run loop, we process the moisture, we read the moisture. So we read from the analog port, we read the value, and then we send the value over the serial port. And you see that I attach these square brackets to the value. Now you also see there analog read sync. Now you have to remember that to read an analog value takes about 100 microseconds. So when you say start measuring, it takes 100 microseconds. Now you can do a lot of things in 100 microseconds. For example, if you need to animate some lights or servos, you really need that time. So there's also analog read async, which has a callback routine where you can set the value. In this case, this is the only thing the application needs to do. So I just wait until I have a value and then I continue with my program. So when the setup is done, we have our main loop. In the main loop, we check if we are blinking. If we're blinking, I call a routine which blinks an LED. And it measures it measures the moisture of the earth. And when there's an alarm, when the moisture is too dry, I show the alarm, and otherwise I clear the alarm. So very straightforward code. I'll demonstrate now what it looks like in the IDE. So here you see, on the left, you see a little demo setup that I have. And on the right, you see the source panel of the Swift for Arduino development environment. And when I click upload, what you see, what happens is that on the right, you see the program being compiled. And then you see the upload status to the device. And once it's uploaded, you see the LED start blinking. So the program is running. Now I can simulate the moisture with a device called a variable resistor or potentiometer. And when I turn the knob of the potentiometer, I change the analog value that is red. And when it's getting too dry, I'll lit up the LED. So you can also show the values that are sent back from the Arduino by clicking the serial port. And when you then start your application, you see the values coming in from the serial ports. And if you turn the knob, you see them change. This is great for debugging. So this concludes Swift for Arduino. Next up, data injection. Now remember, the Arduino sends the values over the serial port. So we need to get the values from the serial port and inject them into an SQLite database. Now, normally I would create a shell script for that. So for example, we have stuff from the serial port. I'll have to do it like this. You pipe it into a stream editor and then pipe it into SQLite. So you have separate programs. So this is a very Unix-y way of doing things. So I started with that. And this is what it looks like. First, you have to set the serial port to a specific baud rate. And you do that with the stty command. And then you cut the device and pipe it into set the stream editor, which inserts some SQL in the front and the back. And then you pipe that into SQLite, which sets it directly into your database. Now, this contains a lot of arcane knowledge. For example, you see an ampersand at the end of the STTY, because STTY sets the baud rate, but as soon as the program finishes, the baud rate defaults to a default value. So what you set there is gone. You have to keep STTY running. Also, the regular expression that you see with set is, I had to look up a lot of things before I got this to work. And this is, again, arcane. There should be a Swifty way to do this. And of course, there is. Otherwise, I wouldn't have a talk. So in Swift, how would you sort of start creating a program like this? You create something like an SQLite handler. And the SQLite handler does things with SQLite. And then you create a serial device, which listens to the serial port. And whenever it finds something, it calls a little routine, the SQLite injector, which injects your value in the database. Now, I found a nice little library to connect to the serial port, which is called the ORS serial port. So I have the serial handler here. And this library has a nice feature where you can define the packet. So if you say, I have a packet which starts with a square bracket and then closes with another square bracket, that value that's in between those brackets, I want you to do something with that. Give me a callback routine. So I set it up here. I create a packet descriptor. And whenever on the serial port it finds that packet, it calls this didReceivePacket routine. And in the didReceivePackets, you extract the value string and send it to your data injector. Very nice. And then in the data injector, you call write, and it's injects, it writes the data to your SQLite database. So what is the database schema that I'm using? For that, we're waiting until we go to Vapor, which is our solution for server-side Swift. Remember, we need a backend with an API to be able to connect from a mobile phone to our data. Or why not at the same time have a website, right? So there are many server-side Swift libraries, frameworks, whatever you call them. There's Kitura, which was from IBM until IBM ditched it. There's Perfect, which is a different paradigm, which is based on Laravel. But I already played with Vapor before, so for me Vapor is easy thing to use. What do we need to create? We are going to create a standard Vapor app, which has a router, and the router connects the endpoints from the URL to functions in your code. We need to create a website which shows the values, and I want an API to be able to use in the mobile phone app. And the whole thing connects to an SQLite backend. And the SQLite backend happens to be the same database as our inject tool, so that makes it really handy. What does our data model look like? Very simple. We have sensors. And we have readings. So we define a sensor as a plant pot with a moisture sensor. And every couple of seconds, there's a reading, and the readings are sent into the readings database. The schema is really simple. Sensor has a dry set point and an image, because it's nice to see an image on the website and in your app, and a name. And the readings contain a date and a value, and they're connected to each other. So if you create a website, it looks like this. You have your sensors and the plants, and the Sansevieria has a value 330, and the aloe vera doesn't have a status because no values were sent yet, readings were sent yet for that plant. The code for this Vapor website is on my GitLab page on the bottom right. But I'm not a front-end person, so there's really basic functionality. I always hate JavaScript and stuff like that. Apart from the website, we also need an API. So we have a very simple API where we show a list of sensors if we want, and it returns some JSON. And we have a list of readings. And that's basically it. But this is not a Vapor talk. So if you want to learn more about how Vapor works, Google a Vapor talk and you'll learn more about that. As I said, the code you can download yourself and play with it if you want. But there's an inherent danger to developing on your Mac while you're deploying on Linux. Because Mac is Unix, but it has very special features. For example, when I was creating this application, I was programming on a Mac because I have a Mac. It's easy, it's nice to work on, it's a familiar environment. But when I was deploying to Linux, it turns out that the nice little serial library that I found does not exist for Linux, because it is a Darwin library. It connects to the Darwin way of connecting with IO toolkit and devices. It's completely useless on Linux. So I found another library, Swift Serial, and I used that. But the problem with Swift Serial is that it had some multi-threading problems and baud rate problems. So I had to work around that as well. Also, SQLite, I found a nice library called SQLite.swift, but also underneath it had Objective-C. So it was also not running on Linux. So I needed to find another library. And I'll show you a little error that I got while trying to get it to compile. And basically, these are the kinds of errors that you get. And it's like hardly Googleable. You can try to find it, but it's it references to like 6 year old blog post about completely different things. So it was very hard to figure out why doesn't this SQLite library not function. In any end, I found another library. So I thought, oh dear, I need to maybe deploy on a Mac for my demo, because there it works. It's sort of like, this is working. I know this. But luckily, in the end, I found a nice SQLite library called Perfect from the Perfect server-side Swift guys. And with that, I was finally able to deploy the Raspberry Pi on the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi code that was meant for that on the Raspberry Pi. Yay! So another step done. I now have an Arduino program, I have a collection tool, I have a backend and a website, and we need to create an app. And of course, nowadays we are going to create an app in Swift UI. So what does the app need to do? It needs to connect to the API, and it needs to display the results in a list. This is fairly basic code, especially in Swift UI. So what does it look like? We have our phone, we have our plants, and when everything is hunky-dory, you see happy smileys. But when one of the plants needs watering, I'll show a little warning sign at the top and show the plant which is in dire need of some water. I'm not going to go into Swift UI because this is not a Swift UI talk, so there are plenty of Swift UI talks, please look there. Conclusions. It is now possible to create a fully Swift IoT chain from the sensor, the edge devices, to the cloud and the end user. We can use data injection using Swift. We can use an API in Swift. We can have a website in Swift. And we can, of course, create a mobile frontend in Swift. More conclusions. Swift on Linux has caveats. And hardware has the word hard in it for a reason. Still, I think that Swift for Arduino is a step in the right direction because it allows for safer embedded development. There is strict type checking, and we can avoid pointers to functions or pointers to arrays and other pointers to memory addresses. So that's great. Currently, it supports Arduino Uno and compatible, so boards that are based on the Atmega 328P chip. But hopefully later this year, it also supports Arduino Mega. And with a bit of luck, also Espressif chips in the future, because the Espressif chips, the ESP8266 and ESP32, have a semi-functional LLVN compiler. So we might be able to do that. It's still very buggy, but it's great if we can use those processors as well. Some references. Swift for Arduino can be downloaded at the top. Unfortunately, it is also in the App Store, but unfortunately Apple does not allow tools. I have to get rid of this stupid timer. Apple doesn't allow compiler tools in the App Store, apart from Xcode, of course. So there's a very limited functionality. You can look at the app, but you're not able to compile code and upload code because Apple just doesn't allow that. My Twitter, if you have questions, and all the code is on my GitLab page, which should have a pointer somewhere, but doesn't. And there's also a GitHub page with stuff. I want to thank. Oh, there it is. I want to thank Marco and Bart from CocoaHeads Netherlands for providing me with all kinds of tools to be able to make this talk. And also Carl Pito for making the Swift for Arduino application, and Daniel Steinberg because he encouraged me to do this talk and helped me guide me with this talk. It was great fun presenting. If you have any questions, I'll be on Slack, so you can ask questions there. Ciao.
Hoi. Zijn er vragen? Ik zag één vraag van Steven van... Oh, sorry. Oh, yes, English. Sorry. Yeah, I've been talking Dutch too much. There was a question from Steven from Impe. And the question was very difficult. At least for me, it was like, what? Okay, so his question is, if classes aren't supported, I assume protocols and existential types also aren't. And I'm afraid I had to look up what existential types are. Sorry, Marco, can you please stop the audio? Thank you, because I hear an echo. Let's see. I had to look up what existential types are. It's like, that thing from Haskell, functional programming, stuff like that, generics, all the stuff that, in my opinion, makes Swift less Swifty, but functional programmers love it. So I never used them on Swift for Arduino, and I had to ask the originator of Swift for Arduino, Carl Peter, who is also in the Slack, and he says, protocols are supported, generics are supported, but existential containers are not supported. So, Steven, I hope that answers your question. I don't see any other questions on Slack. Let's see what's in the YouTube channel. Haha. Thank you, Yoshi Kunifu. Well, apparently it was very easy, or there were no people on the on the stream. Yeah. But as I said, it's really nice to be able to use a proper language instead of C++ to program these little devices. And they have very small versions. Let's see, there should be one here. You see the mess in my room. So this is another one, which is even smaller. And this is yet another one, which is even smaller. So this is a complete computer in a USB stick, which you can play around with and do stuff. No questions. Well, let's have a beer then. I guess if there are no more further questions, are you going to say something about the raffle, Yolanda? I think we should just ban Benji from now on. Oh, actually, he couldn't react because he couldn't listen to the talk live. So he's going to watch it later. That's why he doesn't respond now. BSM. He told me that I couldn't watch it live. Okay, thanks everyone for listening. And if you have any further questions, you can find me on Slack. I'm called... my official name is there. Awesome. So, bye-bye.